Hi guys, welcome to my YouTube channel. I am Denmark Aranas, a postgraduate medical intern. I basically provide informative videos to medical students. And also, I would like to give aspiring Filipino physicians an idea of what a med student usually tackle in med school. If you find these videos helpful, please don't forget to hit the like button and subscribe to my channel. And also, click the notification bell to be updated for my new videos. For today, I'll be discussing the clinical pathologic correlation of pelvic inflammatory disease, or PID. This is an infection of the female reproductive organs, and it most often occurs when sexually transmitted bacteria spread from the vagina to the uterus and the fallopian tubes to the ovaries. The signs and symptoms of PID can be subtle or mild. Some women don't really experience any signs or symptoms until they have trouble getting pregnant and develop chronic pelvic pain. So this is a very important disease for us to understand and for us to prevent tubal infertility among our patients. Here is a brief overview of our CPC, and we'll be discussing this by section. So let's start. Here are the important risk factors that we have to consider: the age of the patient belonging to the reproductive age, those who do vaginal douching, sexually active females, those who use intrauterine device, those with multiple sexual partners, and had prior sexually transmitted infection are the most susceptible to infection. And there are two types, ascending infection and the lymphatic spread. Among the two, ascending infection is the most common etiology for PID. And the organisms include Chlamydia trachomatis and Neisseria gonorrhoeae. These two has a co-infection for PID, and they are the most implicated organisms for PID. Also, we have Mycoplasma genitalium. As for the lymphatic spread, this involves respiratory and gastrointestinal pathogens, including E. coli, Group B strep, Haemophilus influenza, S. aureus, S. pneumoniae, and TB. However, this is rare. So we'll be focusing more on the ascending infection, which would start at the vagina. And this would be manifested as fever, vaginal bleed, discharge, dysuria, and dyspareunia. As for the cervical and then to uterine infection, our patient would experience cervical discharge, anatomic changes in the cervix and even in the uterus, hypogastric pain, and cervical motion tenderness. After that, it would lead to infect the tubes and then the ovaries. And this would be manifested as bilateral adnexal tenderness. And then it would finally reach the pelvic peritoneum, which would be manifested as peritonitis in our patient. And that now would establish pelvic inflammatory disorder, which could occur in subacute to chronic phase. And it would be manifested as chronic pelvic pain. This now would lead to damage to ciliated and secretory cells of fallopian tubes, which would lead to pathological tubal architecture. And it would be manifested in our patient as infertility, ectopic pregnancy, tubo-ovarian abscess, and perihepatitis. And then lastly, it could reach the systemic circulation and it could spread through the blood and would cause sepsis. Here now is the reference of our discussion, comprehensive gynecology. I would like to end this discussion by leaving you with this message. Our time will come. For now, let's appreciate how far we've come already. Thank you for listening and have a good day.